One thing that we heard earlier is the importance of pearls in Jaipur. And my vision is that Jaipur in the future will not be only animals. We really need to bring back the pearls into the Jaipur designs, into the Jaipur culture. So when we do another event or in the future, we're going to start with that. So you can remember this day, we're like the beginning. Okay? And we're going to try and bring many more pearl companies in here so we reignite interest in pearls.
Now, this just kept going. know, just a very typical name, just like my name. And this man was a driving force behind the first commercial pearl farm in Mexico and in the world. In his farm, he grew around between 8 to 10 million pearl oysters. These were all black pearl oysters from Mexico that he taught on supplying them. And his pearls were all natural pearls. He had between 900 to 1,200 employees at the site. He developed unique technologies to produce the pearls. And that number right there, the up to 11% of natural pearl production, that's really fantastic. In his site, he was able to make the oysters produce up to 11% of the population made natural pearls. So it's almost very close to some culture pearl productions like the one we have. Ours is 30%. And we are running culture pearls. The farm was very successful from 1893 to 1914 until we had, of course, the Mexican Revolution. And the problem with the revolution was that he had political enemies. The army arrived in La Paz in South Baja, where it was located, and they basically destroyed everything. They tried to kill Gaston Vives, but he fled to the United States. So that's how he ended up saving his life. But this is a picture of the farm, one part of the farm where the ration system was located, where the baby oysters were grown. So that part was just for the baby oysters. If you visit the island of Espiritu Santo today, you can still see the work of Gaston Vives there. It's an amazing sight. This is one of the technologies, one of his technologies, the pearl oyster body armor. Okay? Some of his oysters, especially the older ones, were given this suit of armor to protect them from predators. All that care and detail went into the individual pearl oysters. Can you imagine that? Now, Mexico today has both a natural and a cultural pearl industry. And most people would say, well, it's only cultural pearls, no, but let me show you what's happening today in Mexico. We're having, first of all, sustainable pearl farming. So that's a photograph of the site where I have my farm. It's in Macrochipan, Copenhagen, Sonora. If you ever go to the Tucson Junction, we're located around 6 hours driving from Tucson in a straight line. There you can see the pearl oyster farm, and we have 200,000 to 300,000 pearl oysters. Pearl farming in Mexico, basically, it's a four-year process. We have a very limited joint intervention. We'll talk more about this. And Cortez pearls, that's the way we brand them, have unique features. Okay, that pearl necklace down there, it was sold. I cannot say who we sold it to, but it's in Caribbean. Next year, there will be an important exhibit, and it will be probably be shown all over the world. This is the pearl oyster that we use to grow our pearls. The rainbow-lipped pearl oyster. The scientific name is Hevia sternum. This pearl oyster is found from Baja California all the way down to Peru, although it lives much more comfortably in the sea of Cortez, where we're located. Now, one amazing thing about this oyster is that it's technically impossible to use for cultured pearl production. I've met people from Tahiti that have visited my farm, and when they tell me, can you please open up a pearl oyster so I can see the anatomy? Sure. I open it up, and they look at me, and they look at the oyster. Look at me, the oyster. Look at me, the oyster. They say, how can you possibly grow pearls larger than 5 millimeters? And then I tell them, well, we've grown up to 17 millimeters, I don't know. So the pearl sac is really constricted. That's a major problem. But we have been able to produce these impossible to produce pearls. We're the only farmers on the planet that use this particular variety of pearl oyster. Tier Cortez pearls, or Cortez pearls, have unique traits. The first of them is that these are not processed in any way. So we don't put any money in fishery, we don't put any bleaching, we don't put any inert, it doesn't glow at all, and ours glows red. So it's a distinguishing feature. It's like having a built-in certificate of authenticity. There's no other pearl that does this. Also, our pearls have a very thick nature coating in South Sea quality. Here you can see some examples, of course, in the center of the mother pearl bead. And finally, the provenance. You can actually see that if you have one of our pearls, it comes from the only pearl farm of its kind in the planet. So it makes for a distinguishing factor. So we actually do have a very special niche pearl. One thing that is important for us as producers is sustainability. You can't grow pearls if the environment is not doing well. So we have to protect it. So for us, sustainability is protection of the environment. So one thing is that when we started researching pearls, it was 1991, and the first thing we noticed is we had less than 300 adult pearl oysters living in a bay that where we have the farm rescue. Less than 300 animals. Today, you can find tens of thousands of pearl oysters living in the wild. Why? Because our pearl oysters in the farm are basically a massive population. And they're breeding, and they're releasing their sperm and eggs, of course, larvae, throughout the Sea of Cortez. They can travel distances of around 180 kilometers away from the point of origin. So we're actually helping to repopulate the Sea of Cortez. The other thing that is important for us is that our pearl farm is a no fishing zone. No one can go inside and fish. Now, this is not possible under Mexican law. Anyone can go into our farm and fish there. Crustaceans, shrimp, snails, whatever, but we just tell people that they cannot. They believe us. And they don't do it. And this is important because our farm is like a Noah's Ark for reproductive purposes. Creatures of all sorts go inside our farm and stay protected here. So that's good. Now, this year's harvest, 2017, the Cortez Mare pearl harvest has been our largest one since 1996 with 10,000 mabi pieces. Here you can see the mabi pieces that were cut from the shell. For our culture pearl production, roughly 1,500 pearls, so around 1.5 kilos. The idea for the size of our farm is to produce between 5 to 6 kilos. Why are we not producing the amounts we want? I touched a little bit on this subject, and it was a global change, environmental change. So we are having global warming. We're having many hurricanes in the area. Every time we get struck by a hurricane, we lose part of the production. And we had a year when we actually had 3 major hurricanes striking the same spot. So, like lightning. This year we had rounder shaped pearls, less narrow shapes. The size is between 7 to 11 millimeters with an average of 8.5. Taking the nature, we seeded some oysters with 5 millimeter beads and they grew up to 10 millimeters. So I think that's really good. And we also have caches with very nice colors, clusters, and shapes, but they're definitely not plentiful. So that's for the Cortez culture pearl. Now, let's talk about the new natural pearl fisheries. Because I already told you about the old fisheries, now we have a new fishery. Look at that image, please, if you can possibly see or understand what it is. Besides watching plastic litter there, these are gigantic mounds of shell. These are from the rainbow that pearl oyster. Recently fished out from the Sea of Cortez. These are in the state of Sonora. The mounds are almost as tall as I am. You can get on top of one and turn around 360 degrees and see mounds upon mounds upon mounds of shell. Why? Because they're being fished out. For pearls, of course. No. This is the most important thing that has changed with the new pearl fisheries. Here's another example that those are snails. A variety of muriscid snail that we have here. It's food. Mexicans didn't eat a lot of seafood. But in the last decade, our intake of seafood has more than tripled. So it's the fishermen going after meat. Pearls are now a byproduct only. And we're getting pearls from many more varieties than before. Even in the good old days, let's call them that way, they were only looking for black pearls and the rainbow lip pearls, like these two examples of the actual pearls that we're seeing these days. But today, it's an amazing variety. Let me show you this. This is from the new pearl fisheries. A record-breaking rainbow lip pearl necklace valued at $5 million. Amazing. Can you imagine how many billions of pearl oysters have to die just to make this? That's why we see all those shells. We have many species now that are being used to obtain pearls, and they are fascinating. The lion's paw scallop and the pectus medusus, which is a big scallop. Look at the pearls. Many of them are baroque shape, some are semi-baroque shape, but look at that pattern. I mean, you've got them in white and in purple, and we also have them in orange colors. The spiny-oriented oysters, omnibus, which are considered the sacred shells by the Aztecs and other tribes from Mexico and Southern America, also producing very unusual pearls. Some look like those candies, corn candies. Some are dull, but look at the one on the big photo. They're starting to appear some that have these unique visual effects that are quite amazing. So those would be of the higher grades. Really astounding pearls that I've been seeing from this variety of animal. Now, the penshells. Penshells are considered to be the animals with the best meat in the Sea of Cortez. They produce a very delicate scallop. And we have two different species from two genus, Pina and Atrina. Now, the pearls are not actually made out of nacre or mother pearl. They're made out of prismatic calcite. They look like mother pearl. And we have basically three different colors, the jet black, the silver, and the jade green. These are penshell pearls. The jade green from Athena Texa. The black ones from Athena Rosa. Pina Rosa on the far right. And also some very unusually shaped pearls that are basically made out of protein. And like that one that looks like a golf tee. So, unusual things. Look at this really beautiful black penshell necklace from Antina Mauer. A beauty, quite gold, diamonds. Also, we have many varieties of clams. We have the cockles, we have a variety of clam that's called chocolate. And most of them, these pearls, of course, they're non-natives, let's call them porcelain pearls. And most of them are just typically white without any distinguishing features, but some, like the one in the center, are coming out with a flame pattern very similar to that of Chidana, the giant clam. So there are constantly new things happening. Of course, we also have gastropods, the snails and conchs. We have the green conch in the Caribbean. We have the horse conch in both of them. Areas of Mexico, tournament shells in the Sea of Cortez in Baja. We have the abalones in Baja. So basically from this variety of animal, we have both nacres and non-nacres pearls. So these are the tournament shells, which are used in barbecues, turbo. They're mainly used for their meat. The shell is used to make jewelry, handbags, and other stuff. And many people are making imitation mocking pearls from the shells, like this one. So maybe you visit a jewelry store and they tell you these are mommy pearls or just pieces of polished shell. And the pearls are exceedingly rare. But since we do have a steady regulated fishery by the government, we might have more 50 carats. It's the most beautiful and noteworthy Mexican common pearl. It's from the first time. And it even has a letter of noteworthiness by the J. So this pearl is flawless, the flame pattern unique. It's a beautiful orange color, amazing. Then we also have the green common pearl that has been producing pearls steadily over the years because there's also another regulated fishery, the PARF. So these are what the industry are sometimes referred to as jelly bean pearls. They're non-nacreous. The color comes from carotenoids. They have a unique flame pattern, and they're very beautiful. Now let's move into the back into the Pacific with the abalone pearls and lesser pearls. So we have three species of abalone: the yellow, the blue, and the white abalone. The pearls can be quite large. I actually have one that I can wear as a helmet. They're nacreous pearls, but they also have lots of protein deposits. Most of them are unusually shaped, and we basically have a sustainable fishery that is regulated by the Mexican government. And that means that the pearls will be available in the future for decades to come. Some examples: the typical shapes are those of the tooths of or the claws of the lost raptors. That's what I've been told. And of course, there are some that are baroque, but more rounder. Look at the colors. Blues and greens, also some violets, but you can also see the protein deposits on the pearls. And they can be set in very interesting manners. Like this example is a piece that was made by a designer friend of mine, Carlos Cabrera, who passed away 1 year ago. And using Mexican silver, the pieces were very attractive to buyers. And this pearl, it's something new. It comes from the snail that I showed you in one of the photographs that we had, this huge mouth. Those snails, exactly as the croissants, they have this beautiful pink, dark pink color in them. And we're getting pearls that are almost ruby-like. A very dark orange, pink, almost red, that are amazing. But since the fisheries are so horrible, I mean, in the sense they go after a target species and they finish off the species in an area, then they move to the next desirable target. So this is a new pearl. We had never seen these pearls before. Now they're becoming a little bit more abundant. But these will disappear, and then a new species will be fished out, and a new pearl will come out in the sea of Cortez. So there are many, many more natural pearls just waiting to be discovered in the following years. So thank you. I tried to do it as fast as possible. Thank you, everyone. Namaste.
Gracias.